your hands together and welcome the Black Prince of the Night.
Life as a Calypsonian not easy. I mean, in the way you think it would be. You better they stay by chill and carefree. I don't know who tell me to get married. From the day your boy venture into married life, one set of pressure getting from my wife. She make me to know that she don't like Calypso. And she see why it is I fighting it so. She tell me, when me a see Calypso, do nothing for you, Calypso. And in the night I can get a good night rest through you, Calypso. And when the season comes, sure to get paid, Calypso. Can't believe it's Calypso, your love so, Calypso. You ain't see Calypso, and I love for you, Calypso. And out of the blue, just so the old man explode, Calypso. When the night time comes, there's a hug up in Calypso, Calypso. Some Calypsonian fool shit. Shelly hair like Calypso or me. This to know the game playing, I doesn't come. Man cutting me up left, right back and the center. And when I turn to June for support at home, I press it, I ready to do the bone, tell you. For me, I see Calypso, do not do for you, Calypso. And in the night, I can't get a good night rest to you, Calypso. Always with a chum-chum on a guitar, Calypso. And not for hell, you can't reach the Savannah, Calypso. Who tell you that you could sing Calypso, Calypso? You're fooling yourself in case you ain't no Calypso. And out of the blue, she tell me this and no sport, Calypso. Let Calypso come and wash them dirty jockey shorts.
Good evening, viewers, and welcome to Calypso Showcase. Our special guest tonight is Kenroy Smith, known in the Calypso world as Black Prince. And Black Prince, we welcome you to Calypso Showcase.
Thank you. Good night.
The name Black Prince, where did it come from?
Well, that name was given to me by the Lord Commander.
And you seem to be have been very friendly with Commander. Tell us a little bit about your relationship with Commander.
Well, when I came out in Calypso, I was very young. And my mother was afraid to send me out at night. And Commander, being the Calypsonian in the closest, he spoke to her and she allowed me to go along with Commander as a guidance. Mm-hmm. So he took me around to the tents and he showed me a couple of things, tactics in putting songs together. And, you know.
What did they call you, Black Prince?
Well, I don't know, something. You see, well, you see, at the time, and the style that my mother had, You know, I wasn't much of a knock about the fella, and she had me this kind of chippity way, I call it, pitching my blonde bed and all them kind of thing, you know what I mean? And somehow that seems to be something a prince should be doing to commander. So,
our opening number tonight was Calypso Horrors, and the line, what Calypso do for you, struck me. What has Calypso done for you in the last 2 years?
Well, in the last 2 years, Calypso really do something for me. In this last 2 years, you know. And maybe it's a good thing I make that Calypso, because before I made that, nothing was happening, you know. But since then, I did a lot. I mean, I come a long way.
Tell me a little bit about the mass camp gig and how it came into being.
Well, I mean, the concert.
The concert that you had with, at the mass camp with Zandali and Blakey.
Well, what I do know is, been there among the years, I've been in the Calypso game, you know. It seemed that David Rudder knew about me then. And as they had this idea, I believe it's a CD, so they wanted more than one person, to, you know. And being Zando, I would veteran, you know what I mean? Somehow they find it was a nice combination, you know. So David Rudder told me about it, and I mean, I was glad for the opportunity. So before you finish, tell me, I say no problem.
You're very happy about it.
Yeah,
you know. Well, I see that you have been performing at the Normandy last weekend. I saw you in a CDC show doing a number. Are you in demand now?
Yeah, at that point.
Tell me something. What do you, when you look back on your career, you know, what do you think accounted for the transition 2 years ago to open up your career?
Well, I believe it started with that old talk, you know, and that old talk started from the amount of years I've been in the Calypso ring. And people seem to find that I had good material, but I wasn't getting anyway. But nobody couldn't pinpoint the reason why I wasn't getting anyway. So then they came up with a problem, that idea that I can't sing with the band. I can't sing with music. And, well, that talk went around. And then it went around to the teacher, around to you. Because I understand that the idea of I singing with the guitar came from you. Because people said they wasn't hearing my lyrics with the band. The band used to drown me and all this type of thing. And I understand, as Frank Martino said, that you all discussed the idea of letting me sing with all the band and see what would happen.
Well, it all started, to put it bluntly, when we did the new releases at the end of 1992.
Yeah,
and you said you didn't have a demo. And I said, well, why not sing just with the guitar?
Yeah.
And that night you were so powerful that the idea dawned on me that maybe you should sing in the tent with just the guitar alone and maybe just a little rhythm section. And you were very, very good in 1993 and 1994, if I may say so.
Yeah.
Well, I think what we want to do tonight is to try and show people a little bit about the Black Prince's career, because I think very few people would know anything at all about your career. So we take a commercial break, and when we come back, we go very close to where Black Prince composed his first Calypso and talk about his Calypso career. Kenroy Smith, known in the Calypso world as Black Prince, tell me, why did you choose this particular location?
Well, I choose this particular location because this is the place that I'm in my first Calypso, and a big stone right in the back here.
What year was that?
That was 1958.
You must have been very young at that time. Tell me something about that year.
Well, that year, I made that Calypso because we had a competition in Nelson Street School, which I won. And, the name of that song was Venezuelan Riot. But the nice thing about that, I wasn't a prince at the time. My name was Lord Sylvester.
Lord Sylvester. Can you remember any part of that Calypso at all?
Well, let me see. I could remember a few lines. Marcus Perez Jimenez had people living in fear and tears. Marcus Perez Jimenez had people living in fear and tears. Imagine a man kill his brother. Over here we call it murder. So the people all hate his head. And is that way causing the big bloodshed? So they're fighting day and night. Pamada, pamada.
and they're fighting for their rights, and they will fight right through the air. Mama, yo, if Jimenez don't clear out of there. You see the pamana, pamana? That was heavy music in them days, you know?
Heavy music?
Yeah, you know, so the whole class went pamana, pamana, and I end up a king.
Did that prompt you to try to get into a Calypso tent or anything like that?
Yeah, well, let's see, at the time, I was pretty young. And then I had an old lady who had a long time training. So she wouldn't allow me to go out in the night. But luckily for me, Lord Commander lived right across here at the time. So he spoke to her and she decided to let me go by the tent. So I went to the tent and I sang the song about two or three nights in Sparrow tent at that year. And well, after that, I made a next song the following year. That was one they called Jagabat.
Jagabat?
Yeah, you know, in them days they had something they call them gold slippers on your feet. And well, fried chicken was always there, you know. So the chorus was something about that. And well, I sang that year too. That was around 59, 60, somewhere around there. And then, well, in 62, I went to audition and I got heartbroken, you know, because I thought, well, I passed the audition and then that wasn't the result.
Which tent did you audition for?
It was the CDC tent. But that audition was kept at upstairs by Lowest Place, Opportunity House. That was the name of the place, right at Henry and Prince Street Corner.
What tune did you use for the audition?
I used a tune, it was Miss Caroline and I still know about the long time version. I fed up, and I can't take it no longer. Long ago was bad, but no worse. For when it ain't goes, it's almost something like that. And I fed up, and I just can't take it no longer. That was the chorus.
Was that the same tune that you used in 1972 to try to get into Blakey's Calypso tent?
Well, that was the same tune that I got into Blakey's tent with in 71.
71.
Yeah, that was after the Tabanka Calypso Tabanka period. Mm-hmm. I met Blakey and I sang the same song because I didn't make any songs during those years. And I got selected to sing at Blakey's Victory Tent in 71. And I did the song there. Well, it was all right. But amazingly, I was singing for all the Bajans because all I knew was the name. I didn't know them. This is what makes the thing nice. Mm-hmm. And Blakey bring the whole side and had them in front. And I singing about, I got chop this one, I got chop this one. And then when I done this, fella asked me, you know who is me? You understand? Then I get to know who was who. But it was good because they seemed to like me from that, you know, to see well, this young fella talking about chop people, and you know what I mean?
Although you'd been associated with Calypso for a very long time, it seems as though not until the early 80s, in fact, in 1981, did your career make some sort of start with, I believe it's a tune, No Woman in Bad. Tell me about that year.
Well, that particular year, I got a record in it because No Woman in Bad was the song, well, it was the biggest song I had at the time since I was in the game, in the tent. That was at the CDC tent, in the town hall. And it was also the first time I made a record, was a 45. The name of that was Friday Evening, the record. So I got selected in the tent with No Man in Bad and Friday Evening.
Many years I go in steady with you, and you never ask for nothing is true. You say you don't really want no money from me. All you need is love and good call. Although you know.
Well, Friday evening, I had this girlfriend, you know, and she come by me right in the back here. A Friday evening, I was half past four and thing, to tell me. She just come to tell me she can't come. And she come from a place called Grand Kwakai. You know, so I laugh because I tell myself, well, it have a message in that piece of talk. You know, I just come to tell you I can't come. And you're on spot. But after she gone, I was telling my neighbor and I laughing and thing, but then I realized she was wise. Because if she didn't come that Friday evening, I went to her notes change Saturday morning. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So then I put the whole thing together and I come up with this song. Friday evening, try and come Saturday morning, not to come because the morning I walked in Cambridge by the ghost, she do.
So Friday evening, try and come Saturday morning, not to come. The money where I walk in for can make to a lazy goosey dance. So Friday evening, try and come Saturday morning, not to come. I want to feel, I feel that you should feel for the money where your boy walk in for him.
About that year was that I was attracted to your style of singing Calypso, the sort of deadpan approach, the accent on lyrics, and the humor in your Calypsos. And I remember talking to you and you sort of gave me an idea of a lot of Calypsos that you had written in the past which hadn't been heard by other people, which hadn't made any particular impact. And one of them that stood out in my mind was a little one you made on Carnival. I do remember the exact name of it. I think you're a holiday for Carnival or something like that. Can you remember that?
Make Carnival a holiday.
Make Carnival a holiday.
Yeah. That's,
can you remember any part of that Calypso?
Yeah, I could remember a few lines.
I appreciate that.
If we should make it, then it's high time we start it. There's a lot of rumor going on about promoting culture all over the nation. But yet like we stagnant. For the Prince of a little idea, I will really like you to hear. Because I think it's time that we draw the line and do something that we can proudly say that's mine. And if I set the pace, why can't you join the race? And then we could pray that Carnival be a holiday.
I think that things are very well structured, Calypso, and a powerful message indeed. Where did your career go after 1981 with the small measure of success that you enjoyed?
Well, it was a lot of ups and downs, you know, a little here and there, because as you see, up to now, I'm still kind of husky in the truth. So I had this major voice problem, so I was kind of in the background for a while. And then, you know, I had a big time job in the tent for a few years. I was the foreman at the bench, you know, by the bench. You know what I mean? So being the foreman at the bench, a few years went by and I sang maybe one night a season, two night, because again, at that time, the tent was different, eh? Because it had a lot of more tent-type calypsos. So then it had more men making the program than now in that particular way.
Right.
So you're fine, well, it's when they get a break, they squeeze in a fella. So all of that contributed to I becoming the foreman at the bench.
Well, in 1984, I remember another profound calypso that you made, One Lifetime Is Not Enough. And before we go into that, I want to tell me, what gave you the inspiration for that particular calypso?
Well, what gave me the inspiration for that calypso is that I think most times I make a calypso, let us say, well, I believe all of my songs are outstanding songs, eh? But some that stand out a little more among the rest. It's a song that I get from under deep frustration, you know, at times when, you know. And I was going through that particular period because I told myself, well, since I'm a little boy in this kind of thing and I can't get away. So I tell myself another thing, I can't get no employment and all this kind of thing. So I tell myself, well, it look like I got to live out this whole lifetime and nothing happened. So I got to get the next lifetime.
Yes, it is nice to get in conversation with women. For you will hear some things that you wouldn't hear. them was man with the wood and do. And who man they know more to be than who. Of the wood and live bachelor, the whole life long.
Yes, and I've been a fella around the club life and thing. And you meet, you know, prostitutes, you know, they seem to have a lot of sad stories and some of them seem to have a lot of hope at the time, you know what I mean? And I gather the same type of thing in common from one or two of them, you know. But why I had to be doing this thing and my children and all of that, when this thing go, when I get a good man, then, you know, the kind of chippiness. And I just bundle up everything along with my position and I put it together.
Children, they have no shoe for their feet. To maintain them, their father playing hide and seek. Life is what to make it, she say, seems out of place. Very few could make it today in this rat race. And praise to those who are not spiritual.
Another aspect of your thing is the auditions. When I used to attend the auditions in the NCC or CDC tent in those days, you would always be the one to break down the little audience that was there. And I remember one year you sang a tune, which I haven't heard you sing lately, called Herpes and AIDS. And I was very impressed with the originality. Perhaps you can remind me of that calypso today.
Well, I had to make it a must and remember to sing this one. I know you love this one. Let me see.
Them people in tongue, they play in their way. But I know two fellas go cram their style. One of them come down from New York. The next one is known on the block. Anyway you go, about them this is the talk. How all through the air they humble. But for carnival is trouble. Better watch your case. If you tangle with them is waste. Look here, hoopies and the partner aids. Them is the men afraid. For carnival, they cut in like blade. I say any corner you turn. Bet your life them are wrong. And once you have Sikara, we'll all fall down. And they may care whether big or small. No respect for human at all. And they twice as vicious with alcohol. Husband taking a side. Housewife they running and hide. This soap is an AIDS in the island wine, so watch your hide. And if you have any pride, man, watch your backside. Baby, da 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 da.
Massive jinga vitamin and bat. Them type of men in Sweden who has that. But this one they calling Hopis, he does have you down on your knees. Up in Levante, he arising everybody. And I hear up in Maraval, he's running his own bacchanal. I even get to hear about a little one named Gonare. Look here, Hopis and Ifanaids. Something like that.
Another tune that stands out in my mind from that era, I don't remember exactly what year, was a tune called Fry Ball. And perhaps you can give me the story of Fry Ball.
Well, you know, well, in them times, you know, I had this girlfriend and she was pregnant, so she say, and then people say she ain't pregnant. You know this kind of thing? They say she was trying to tie me foot to get married and she say she pregnant. And she sister tell me and she friend of them say, if she pregnant, she can't be pregnant, must be Fry Ball. You know, this kind of thing. And I put the whole thing together because I tell myself it could be true.
Well, I find myself tied up just recently. Friending with a girl, see she making baby. First time in my life I hear my name call. Could imagine how I
was a sort of a breakthrough year for you. Sparrow's Tent and a tune which I personally witnessed you getting a number of callbacks. The name of the tune was Private. Tell me about how you managed to get into the Sparrow's Tent and the tune Private.
Well, from early, you know, early o'clock, I was always in the Sparrow Tent. Somehow I seemed to like to be in Sparrow Tent. So even from since in the 60s and them times, I was always in the Sparrow Tent. I wasn't on every, sing every season, but I was always there. So then, as you know, I sang a few years in CDC Tent. And then I decided that I wanted to try and get my act together. And I went down to the Sparrow Tent. And I got selected with Private. Because it had something was going on with the tent that year, and I get a last minute selection. I think I went down there the Sunday, you know, and the body liked the song, and well, that was it. So I sang the song, and I want to see a Private. Something flat. But this one is here private. It's the same thing, you know, Trinidadian have a way that they just say it's one thing and mean something, you know what I mean? And again, you know, this lady, she want to see me. And instead of she say, well, Prince, I want to see you important, I want to see you privately. She called me out in the road and said, I want to see you private. I mean, as man, where you feel, we go think.
Boy, I tell you, I really do understand. Language of some Trini woman. For they always sing something back to front. How they want me to know just where they want. They don't see anything that come to their mind. And they have a different part behind. The lady make my brain insist when she tell me words like this. I want to see your private keys.
Where do you get the ideas for your calypsos?
Well, I would tell you, no, many a time I try to get a topic, or I try to create something, because maybe this is what made me successful in auditions especially. Because as you know over the years, you hardly find an ex-guy swing and coming with the thing I come in with.
Original topics.
Yeah, you know, and this is one of the things. So I always try to think of something I almost sure nobody wouldn't come with, you know? And then another thing, Commander, is a fella, he always tell me, if you want to get humor in Calypso, you either capsize the idea or you turn it left side. You understand? What he mean is, if I want to sing about your color, the color of your shirt, well, turn wrong the shirt. So then I ain't singing about right side, I sing about left side. And I mean, I try it and I get to realize it really get humor. Because it'll be saying the set thing, but you just get a different twist. Or you say it in a different tone. You understand?
I understand.
And together with imagination, you see, human calypso call for a lot of imagination. And you have to psych up yourself in that frame to put it out, you know, as to, in order for you to be serious and get people to laugh.
The opening of the vintage Calypso tent in 1992 was a breakthrough year for you, and the tune Calypso Horrors really had people tickled with laughter throughout that Calypso season. Talk about that year for me.
Yeah, well, that was a nice year. You know, what made it nice was everybody in the tent, you know, I saw that the committee, you know, everybody light Calypso Horrors. And it's a song that had me breaking the curfew, because Vintage was organized during the curfew time. You know, so many a time when they had a meeting with Winston Minard and Beckway and these people, when I drop out, the maxi, I had to run to reach home because the time, you know? And all of that was Calypso Horrors.
I tell you, this wife of mine, she not easy. Trying she best to send me crazy. Forever taking off string from me guitar. Telling me I was them and can't remember. She does wait until she see that I'm composing. Start throwing down where's had in the kitchen. And we are sitting down, come sweeping around, telling me check a blacksmith and pong me tongue, I tell you. For me, I see Calypso do nothing for you,
Calypso.
And in the night, I can't get a good night rest through you,
Calypso.
Always with a chung chung, don't make me cuss. Between you and Rex, we don't know who
what?
Calypso.
Telling me you love Calypso, but you lie.
Calypso.
It's them woman and them way born in your eye.
Calypso.
And out of the blue, I get the shock of my life.
Calypso.
You go use the hole in your guitar when you're a wife.
Calypso.
Well, I think whenever anybody says Black Prince, immediately the tune that comes to mind is The Letter. And I think you have to give us the story of The Letter.
Yeah, well, The Letter is an ex frustrated, come out of the frustration, as I tell you. I was looking for some work on them. This maximum prison they have in the back of Aruka. I spent over 3 months going there every day, sitting down outside looking for the song. And every time I get to see the man by the door, he tell him, why I don't get a letter from Jared Narain? Because at the time I was living at Aruka, why I don't get a letter from the parish priest? Why I don't get a letter from the police, if you help me? And after 3 months and I'm on and I'm going back after, I ain't getting no work. And it just come to my vex. I eating up myself, I cursing within myself. And I tell myself, but the next thing I put it up to some woman and she tell me, get a letter, bring a letter.
I see the girl, oh Lord, may I catch at she. I tell myself, me I can't wait getting she cost me. I see myself one time with her family. I even see she having we first baby. So I decide to approach the young lady and express the feelings that I feel for she. But when I finish talk, she answer no. Oh yes, I wish she tell me nobody in here can guess. She tell me to bring a letter from her last woman. She's signature, stating why we done. Bring to passport picture of the woman too. I want to know how much children will she have for you. If she have a phone, bring the number so that I could confirm later. And if I get rid of in the letter, she still go need a medical from a doctor. I never hear more. You could have swear is a work I was looking for. Well, if you see this smooth, good-looking ducky, Brigo is the perfect flip side to she. She have me can't sleep when the night time come, wondering who I go get a letter from. So I decide to ask 2-3 girls I was with. When they see me come in, well, them start to spit. This other one tell me, don't frighten, check she home, she go give me it. But when I reach, she start to call for rape and bandit. And I have to get a letter from my last woman. Suitable information, stating what went on. I tell myself when I don't rest the hurt on she. I buy in my own self a trophy in memory of all them up and down I do. In getting my credential to get through. But where you think happen? You know the blasted girl is a homo.
What is 95 hole for you?
Well, 95 hole, a lot of hope. Hope and a lot of things I believe will happen for me 95 because again, I had to say thanks to David Rudder and the engine room people for giving me this opportunity with the concert we had and the recording because a part of that coming to one lifetime, I never thought I would get a recording this lifetime. You know what I mean? And I believe with that, and a little tea I have in the bag for 95, I believe that I'll be sitting pretty.
Up in the wake and the kind of things I hear is the reason why that I wasn't there. Oh, he was a loving man, very quick to understand, always gave a helping hand, devoted to his wife and children. Well, them had me wondering if he's the same man with them meaning. For the fella way I know, nothing love back out is so. Always by some rum shop door, have a soul food we can cure. Always dirty, never clean, smelling like rotten dashing. That is why I didn't go. The man they buried, the man I know.
Well, I can imagine how that's going to develop from there, knowing you.
Yeah.
Well, what I want to close with tonight, with Black Prince's permission, because Black Prince rubbed shoulders, actually, with this guy in the 80s. We regret to announce the passing of a relatively unknown Calypsonian, Clifford Caesar, known in the Calypso world as C Major. He sang in 1984 at the CDC tent the tune The Contenders, and then he sang Invasion in 1986 and Children of a Lesser God at the Sparrows Young Brigade in 1988. But he was, perhaps his one famous calypso was the tune that Baron sung this year, Find Yourself. And we're going to close with Baron, Timothy Watkins Jr., singing this song, which was composed by Clifford Caesar, C Major.
Everybody talking about rehabilitation, while endless atrocities spreading through the nation. Amendments debate said on the radio station, but what have they contributed to my fallen nation? Boy, we lament, we need change betterment in this land. While all this time we consort with corrupt action, for there is no other means or way. No. if you don't find yourself, you cannot be someone else. And these are meaningful ideas I say.
Greatest happiness one can find, just to be there.